Hey folks, we're back. Chris Garlock, Michael Redmond with our latest AlphaGo versus the world. Michael, we have a player today who we've seen a couple of times before, but you'll probably want to remind folks about who he is.
It's Meng Tailing, sixth dan at the time. He promoted, I think, to seven dan later. And he's been a fairly successful player, but mostly famous for being a presenter at the WeiqiTV, which is a Chinese, it's on the internet, but it's a channel where they do a lot of broadcasts about Go, of course. Mm. And so he's the presenter for that, and he's very good, actually. I've been watching him, and I don't understand the Chinese very much, but it's good when it's Go. So I just watched it.
We're not picky. We just like stuff that's Go.
Yeah. So in this game, I'll just jump into it. AlphaGo has black, and we're seeing what I've been calling AlphaGo's favorite opening. And he plays the big Shimari, and white plays a Kakari. And we've been through this before, actually, where white plays here.
Yep. Yep.
In fact, that's even in the last game.
Yeah. I was getting a feeling of deja vu all over again.
Yeah. I'll just mention that this move, actually, I could show you something slightly different here and say that although this is by far the most common move for humans to play, you can see sometimes moves like this which do complicate it. So I could talk about that later sometime. White would probably, in this case, white could continue in the corner with something like this, and white would have this big threat in the lower right corner, which is something that white would be able to look forward to be playing next. So it would heat up the lower right corner and give white some options there fairly soon in the game. So I think this is perfectly okay for white. Other moves that black could try would be this, but this one gets really complicated. I actually did some things about this in my Joseki book, I think. In my Joseki video. So we'll leave it there. But this is definitely the move that I would like to play. This is the one that I've played in similar board positions. And it seems to work fairly well for me. And we get into this variation, which you have probably seen me do before.
But I have.
White does get this nice position on the right side.
I can't wait to play in one of my games. I'll be like, hey, AlphaGo likes it. Michael likes it. I'm going to totally butcher it now.
Yes, but everyone was playing this extension. This was, at the time, it was considered to be a pretty good opening for white. And it was very popular. And then white would play the pincer. And although the players have had, like, this is maybe the fifth game or something like that in which this board position has come up. And the players are realizing that things are going wrong for players because everyone's losing, right?
Right.
But they don't realize that this move is apparently the problem because now we have computer programs like Lila Zero and Katago and more, others too, which will tell us that it's not good to play the pincer when black can play a pressing move here. And this is the move that you usually see humans play at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And so instead, white is supposed to be playing something like maybe here. The one that I might play in a game would be this one, which is pretty solid, taking the corner, stuff like that. And white's not supposed to pincer because black gets to press here.
Right.
So that's our standard.
Is the Kasumi at all playable, or is it just way too slow for white?
The Kasumi can be played too. It's actually this move has also made a revival. In either case, white is being relatively protective of the lower left corner in a position where black does have this position as a strong position on the right side. So you could say black has a local advantage, and white has to play defensively here.
Mm-hmm.
And among those, I'm just going to say that this is the one that I like best. Because moves like this, after black plays something like this, there is still some potential for black to be putting pressure on white with a move like this, for instance.
Mm.
And the fact that there's just so many more black stones in the immediate area makes me sort of like the idea of cooling things down with this variation, which white's territory is already established. And the whole area loses its value after this. So I sort of like that one. Everyone thought pincering was very natural with that white stone in the upper left corner. Obviously, white should pincer. That's what we thought. And we learned that black can press here to get an advantage. But actually, when this exchange is being played, AlphaGo plays this way, the large knight's move. And actually, we talked about this in the last game.
We did, yeah.
27. And I'm still thinking it's slightly better for white to play this move. And we went into some variations for that last time.
Yeah.
But let's just talk about the game variation in this case. So Meng Tailing is, he's going to do the crawling move again. So we're back to the pattern of games number 5, 7, and 9. And I think it might even have been Meng Tailing who played one of those first games. So he's playing the same move again, and he's going to try something different later. And black plays here. At this point already, the winning percentage is pretty good for black. When black plays here, let's see, it's move 21. Already black's getting close to 60%. So when black plays this Kakari, black is at 60%, 11 points before Komi. So that's a pretty big advantage. And the other option for white is to play an extension here, but this does get a bit, it gets a bit confusing. Like white, if white plays here, then white will have a lot of trouble trying to escape. Sometimes I will see my computer program suddenly just sacrificing the whole side, and it's sort of hard to understand what's going on here. And it does look a bit better for black anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And so the way computer programs act when the game is, when the winning percentage is already low, is sometimes a bit different from the way humans act, because humans try to make the game confusing and complicated when they're having a hard, when they're falling behind. Whereas computer programs don't seem to necessarily do that.
Mm-hmm. I want to ask a question. I want to go back here because, as we've talked about a number of times, the normal play was always thought for, you know, in the sequence would be to extend one more because the honey was going to be so big, right?
When, you always thought the honey was so big. This would allow white to play something towards the left side, so maybe here.
Right, but that's not what I wanted to ask. What I wanted to ask was, because to your point, is that, you know, folks had not figured out to stop pincering, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
But how come they didn't figure out? Because here's AlphaGo playing the sequence that they've been playing, and AlphaGo does not play the extension. That would be a big clue to me to mm-hmm. maybe rethink.
Rethink crawling.
Yeah.
It was just that this is a very effective move if black covers here. And the players had experience with this entire opening board position with both sides. It had been very popular among human pros before this series started. And so they had already come to the conclusion that if black gets the cover at this point, they thought it was good for black. But it actually, it is good for black. But that goes back to the pincer here. If you ask the computer programs, the pincer was white's mistake. And even though this is good for black, it's better than the game variation, basically.
Right. Yeah, I was actually just
so that's something that we didn't realize. And so we were discarding this variation for white because we could see that it was good for black.
Right. No, actually, I was just asking something else, which is the next move here. White crawls. Mm-hmm. White plays there. What I'm just saying is that black's play here, AlphaGo's play here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Would a big to me is a big red flag because I'd be like, wait a minute, how come AlphaGo doesn't play
the extension, right?
Yeah, everybody should have been
like, white plays a honey here, and I think we're going to see this in this game too. Actually, every time white tries to attack this black group, it's completely useless almost. Like it doesn't work. The attack doesn't work. And AlphaGo is going to dodge it quite successfully every time.
Right.
And that's something that probably you might say we didn't know how to do that before AlphaGo.
I see. Okay.
So white jumps out and black extends. And I mentioned before that white should probably play here. I'll just show you something slightly different here. Another possible variation is white peeping here. And this is a bit more exciting in that black is going to switch to the corner and not going to connect there. This might be better for white. In any case, white has to play this kick in the upper left corner. And just taking the position on the upper side, basically it's the whole upper side area that is the final big frontier or the big area that both players can surround. So taking this position here, white's either going to get the corner or white's going to get the side territory, one of the two. And so taking that position there, and, if we just look at the remaining parts of the board, they're fairly evenly pieced up. The problem is that at some point, black's going to jump in here and make trouble. But if white could get that right side territory, white would potentially be ahead in territory. So this is relatively good for white if we compare to the board, the game position. In the game, white curled around here. And this was pretty common at the time. But
yeah, once white does, we've seen it before, right?
We've seen it before. But once white does that, white's gradually just getting worse and worse.
Right.
Here again, white should have been playing this move, whereas white comes from the center. And it's sort of strange to see a number of players making the same mistake.
I was just going to say.
Part of it is that it's just the short period of time. Like, this is played the same day as the previous game. And so maybe he just reasoned that it was some different move that was the real mistake. In fact, this is probably in an identical board position, except for this one stone, if we compare it to game number 27.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And the result's going to be the same.
The result was the same every time. So,
that
yeah.
Was a joke.
Yeah. Okay, I will show you one more thing. Since I mentioned that the attacks never worked, we're going to see how this attack turned out. So white cut here because the ladder favors white. And black's going to pretend to attack the ladder anyway for a while and then comes back to connect here. So we have this wild fight starting in the center. And it's sort of hard to tell what's going to happen because we both sides have these weak stones here.
Right.
And black's not alive in the corner yet. So white cuts and curls around. And black lives in the corner. It sort of looks like white might be starting to attack here.
It does.
But the reason this did not work is that all of white's strength that white's building here, we're going to see black pushing along the sixth line now. All the strength is pointed towards these two black stones, which are already taking a stance in the lower right corner. So it's going to be relatively difficult for white to make use of that wall there. There's black stones already taking some important points in the lower right corner. It means that it's going to be difficult for white to do anything there. So black just pushes along for a while. And then there's this move. This is a move that any human player would find too, but the way AlphaGo set it up was really beautiful. And black gets this squeeze, and like this. So at this point, AlphaGo is already 78%. So that's almost 20 points on the board.
My gosh.
I'll say the game is over at this point.
Yeah. What a weird sort of sequence in the middle there. I can't wait to see the analysis in the book because it's.
Well, white was trying to attack, but the end result was that black was getting some thickness there. That's the way it turned out.
Interesting. And it almost seemed like black was sort of dangling a little string there for the cat to chase.
There,
AlphaGo, such a cruel mistress. All right. Thank you, Michael. Thanks, everybody, for watching. We'll just stick with us. We're doing the whole series, all 60 games. And as we've mentioned before, this is sort of building the base for Volume 2 of AlphaGo to Zero. And you, of course, can check out Volume 1, which is already out. So thanks again. See you next game.